Good evening. I just wanted to do a follow-up video. I was going to say quick. It ain't going to be quick. Strap in, because this is going to be a long video. It's not light content. The first half is going to be definitely more point-by-point, lighter content. The second half is going to have to get into like some philosophy, and it's a discussion that can't happen without being predicated on a bunch of ideas that have to be, you know, dealt with. We're going to do it in two parts. The first part's going to be sort of just addressing some points about the video, maybe stuff I would have added or emphasized if I had, you know, done the video not so off the cuff. So the second half is going to be dealing with some comments and links that were posted in the comments that are real interesting and offer a really good opportunity for discussion. It's good to have that stimulus of the comments. You know, there's a lot of smart people here that have done a lot of interesting things, and you know, it's good to have them kind of poke the subject a little bit and bring up opportunities for discussion and you know, new ideas. So all right, first off, the point of the video was not to sell a handle oiling system. You know, I gave, as I said in the video, my current evolution of where I'm at with oiling handles, and it's a real simple system. It works for me, and I've been liking it a lot. But the point of the video was to bring up these three points, elucidate them, state them clearly, use that as a framework in which to think about the problem. And those, of course, are penetration, saturation, and coating. That is, you know, an open discussion. It's a loose matrix in which to think about the physical relationship of the oil to the wood. You know, we could discuss different types of oil and we can go off in different tangents, but this is about the physical relationship of that oil to the wood and what it may or may not be doing for us when it's at those different places in those different concentrations. Linseed oil and flax oil, they're the same thing. They come from the plant Linum utissimum, I think, and it's an amazing plant. It makes the fiber linen, plus it makes the seed with this amazing drying oil. Incredible plant. They're the same thing. The only difference maybe would be that a grower might choose different varieties depending on whether they were growing for industrial use or for food use for the oil. The oils that we want, the fatty acids that we want that dry, are pretty much the same ones that everyone's after, like the health food people are after. I have two tubs with like a dry skin on top of them. They were made at the same time. They've been sitting inside for, I think, over a year, maybe even a year and a half. I've just lost track. Forever. The only difference is one that I can tell is one is darker, and it was always darker. That's the industrial one, and the food grade one is much lighter colored, like a real light yellow. So I wouldn't worry about that, and I haven't noticed any problems with the working qualities at all. Some people mentioned boiling the oil, like cooking it to flocculate and coagulate out proteins or some other, you know, junk that you don't want in there from the cold pressed oil. My axe guy that I mentioned did say that. He said that he uses cooked oil with 50% oil and 50% turpentine, cooked briefly to, yeah, get the junk out, whatever that junk is. Someone said it degrades the oil or something like that. I've never done that. It's something I want to research because I have a lot of good old paint references, and I know some of them are going to have, you know, recipes on how to do that. In the meantime, I'll definitely try it. So why a drying oil? My reasoning is that I want this cured rind of oil in the outside of the handle. Like, that's what I want. And I think I, you know, from the feel of the wood that I have and my personal experience, like doing this and handling it, I think that we are getting a cured rind of oil that's like mixed into the matrix of the wood and makes this kind of composite material. That's what I want. So I think that happens, and that's why I favor using a drying oil. Other additions. Yes, I've definitely thought about using other additions. I made this many years back. I don't remember how many. And it's a side stone holder, so this gets filled with water. It's made out of redwood, and then this, you know, goes on your belt on like a little clip. And when I was done making this, before I, you know, put the clip on and everything, I soaked it in hot beeswax, pine pitch, and linseed oil and just tried to saturate it completely. It works great. You know, it holds water completely. It doesn't seem to soak up any water. It doesn't crack. You know, beeswax, it's obviously it's solid at room temperature. Pine pitch is more solid at room temperature. So you're either going to need a solvent or you're going to need heat, one of the two. Definitely have some ideas on experimenting with that, but we'll see. Another thing I wanted to talk about is controlling the depth of saturation. So I have had some ideas about controlling the depth of saturation or the depth of penetration. First of all, I feel like boiled linseed oil doesn't penetrate as far, either because it dries quickly or because it's naturally thicker, maybe. That's if applied in the open air, though. It's not, the drying part wouldn't be a problem if you were soaking it, is what I'm saying. But if you're applying it freehand to the outside, like every so many times a day or something like that, say several times a day, then it cures really fast. So it might start to cure and then stop the oil from going any deeper. Heat. Obviously, hot oil is more liquid. Probably the pores of the wood open up if they're heated, maybe. Only if the handle and the oil are warm, it's going to go in there faster. It seems apparent that that would, intuitively, that that would increase penetration and the depth of saturation. Back to oil thickness, there are other preparations besides linseed oil and boiled linseed oil. There's also sun-thickened linseed oil, which is a preparation that goes way back, and it's made by just standing linseed oil in the sun and stirring it, you know, often enough that it doesn't form a skin on the top. And it can get quite thick, kind of like honey. I have some. I'll show you right now. Why not? There's some right here, I think. So this stuff has just been sitting on a shelf. It's got this skin on top that's flexible, but it, you know, it's a pretty tough leathery skin, like it's actually a little hard to tear here. And below it here we have this stuff. See how thick that is? It's like honey, basically. It really is. It's like the consistency of honey. You put that on a handle at room temperature, ain't going nowhere, you know. I mean, it's not going in there very far. And artists mix this stuff together, right? They'll take this and they'll mix it with raw linseed oil and turpentine and whatever else they use to get the consistency that they want and the effect that they want. There's ways to tweak this stuff, is what I'm saying. So that's one way that you could affect the depth and rate of penetration if you wanted to. Schedule and curing time. So what I've noticed I've done before is if I'm just putting a bunch of oil on the handle and it's just soaking up endless amounts of oil, and I'm like, kind of like, yeah, maybe that's enough. I might let it sit for 4 weeks and then start oiling it again so that some of that oil can cure and slow penetration, and I don't get as much, you know, I want to slow that penetration so I can like build up the oil quicker in the outside layer of wood, and then it eventually cures in there and forms this sort of, like I keep saying, like a rind of cured oil in there. Those are some points that I just wanted to make and talk about. There's a lot of food for thought right there. I mean, there's some pretty interesting stuff to get your brains going and formulate some experiments. I've had a bunch of experiments I've wanted to do for quite some time relating to all this stuff and oiling handles, and I definitely want to research drying oils and traditional stuff a lot more too. I'm going to take a micro break here. Now there's a comment here that I wanted to read, and he put in a couple of links that are really interesting and provide, the comment and the links provide a good framework for discussion and good stimulus. Very interesting stuff, very relevant. Okay, so the comment from the Whiskey Gunner. What we believe very much applies here, comma. Our beliefs clearly supersede the facts in this regard, period. Almost certainly linseed oil does not penetrate any further than the surface, comma, let alone to the core. And very likely, if it did, it would in fact weaken your handles. What he's referring to is a couple of links. And there's a link to a blog, Traditional Tools. And he also has a YouTube channel that's worth checking out. He does lots of stuff on axes. So if you're into axes and you haven't checked him out, definitely go check him out. And in the article, in the blog post, which is basically an experiment in penetrating hickory handles with linseed oil, so very relevant, he links an article that's to a scientific study. It's about penetrating wood with linseed oil and then testing it for strength. I'm going to deal with the blog post and what I can remember of it and the study, which I looked at both semi-carefully. The gist of the comment, if you don't take it too literally, you know, he's found information that linseed oil doesn't penetrate the wood, hickory, specifically, I suppose. If it did, it would weaken our handles, and that has to do with this study. Okay, so traditional tools did this interesting experiment, and as I remember, my memory might be a little off here, but he did four pieces of handle. One was just coated repeatedly, and you know, like the oil allowed to sink in maybe, and then oiled again. I don't know how much that was carried on. I don't remember that. Something along those lines. The pieces of handle were soaked. To read this, it sounds like Whiskey Gunner thinks that the conclusion drawn from that experiment are that linseed oil does not penetrate significantly, and that certainly not to the core. But there's so many variables that are not taken into account in that conclusion. Now, it's one thing to do a study and gather data, but the interpretation of that data is an entirely different thing. So let's look at some of the variables that could affect this versus what I do. And first of all, I just want to say, you know, for me, I have a high level of confidence that linseed oil soaks into hickory deeply based on my experience. You know, if I put a third of a bottle of linseed oil on a handle and I don't see it on the floor, and I know it doesn't evaporate, and I don't think there's any mice licking it up, and I'm seeing it soak into the wood over and over again, and the wood feels different, and it looks different, you know, I have a high level of confidence that that oil is going into the handle. So that's where I'm coming from. This is like personal data that I've collected by personal experimentation. So right off, you know, I'm like, well, no, that's not true. We can't conclude that. And the reason we can't conclude it from this experiment are numerous. Okay, like I said in this last video on the penetration saturation coating and in other places, different pieces of hickory behave differently. I've had handles that I expected to take up a lot of oil, like an old cracked handle or something, that just would take up very little oil, and then it's just finished and it dries and it just won't take up much oil. Other pieces will soak it up like a sponge. So from my personal experience, I also have pretty high confidence that there's a big difference between different pieces of hickory. So there's a major variable right there. Another variable is that he used boiled linseed oil in the experiments. I made it pretty clear that I use raw linseed oil, although my reasoning was more that it dries slower, and if you're soaking it in the boiled linseed oil, that shouldn't really matter. But it could be a higher viscosity. Point being, it's a different oil than the oil that I use. And then there's the amount of time. I mean, who says 6 days is enough? The one that was soaked for 6 days did show more oil throughout the handle, and it showed it widely dispersed. As I remember, there were maybe some tentative conclusions drawn by the blog post. I actually don't really remember, but I don't think he was drawing like a lot of conclusions like that, because clearly it's a very limited, you know, experiment. And this is true of experiments in general. And then this is a pretty controlled experiment. You have like three things and they're in the same basic environment, and they're real similar. And you have the main variable is the time, right? The time, except for the one that was coded repeatedly. But it's a limited experiment. You know, it's performed under limited conditions. And you do that on purpose to eliminate confounding variables, right? So you want to eliminate a bunch of stuff that could throw the experiment off. Like, for instance, if each piece of wood was from a different tree or something like that. But in doing so, you limit the amount of, you know, relevance to real life, because we've only tested, you know, this one thing. So we could start expanding the experiment to get more data that might be more relevant to us. But relevance, you know, relevance of the data, relevance of conclusion and interpretation of the data are all really important. Next step is taking that data and saying, okay, now what do we know from this data? You know, in no way is it safe to conclude that linseed oil does not penetrate hickory, or that it won't penetrate to the core, or that very little penetrates it from this experiment. Now, to take that data and apply it to the rest of us and the rest of our axe handles and our linseed oil and all of that is extrapolation. And extrapolation is fraught with danger. Should you never do it? So that's a personal thing. Like, how you want to act on the information you get is fine. You know, this tells us it's interesting. It tells us something. It's not that interesting to me, because there's stuff that I know that affects how I see this information. You have to gather accurate data in the first place, but that's just the start. Like I said, you know, interpreting the data and what the data means, and then what it means to real life. You know, that's what like these discussions are for at the end of a scientific paper. Is you're saying, well, you know, maybe this means this, or maybe we should do this experiment, or this could mean this. A scientist should be really careful about those assumptions that are made in potentially extrapolating information into real life where it's supposed to actually benefit the rest of us, right? Which brings us perfectly to the study. Now, the study is a study on the penetration of oil into wood as a preservative, as an alternative to other maybe toxic preservatives of wood. Take this wood, we're going to impregnate it with drying oil, linseed oil, and then we're going to test it for strength and study it. So they did this, and they, you know, saturated these samples. They put actually different amounts of oil into the wood samples, and then they put them on a press with a you know, like a certain shaped piece of metal, and they pressed on the wood and measured the breaking strength of the wood in, I believe, four different directions, which would be... So they tested the wood, and I think if I understood, I freaking hate reading scientific papers. It's like my least favorite thing to do. But I made an effort to go through it a bit. My understanding is that they tested the wood this way, this direction, you know, not on edge, not shape a piece of wood shaped like this. I'm just trying to point out the grain directions that they tested. So this way with the grain, this way with the grain. So that means, you know, one is, say, like the growth rings are like this, one is like pushing into the growth rings, and one is pushing between the growth rings, on and across the grain. I believe that's my understanding. There was like a diagram missing. And the conclusion was that the more saturated the oil was, or the wood was, the weaker it was. And they went in with, you know, maybe a microscope or something, and they discerned a mechanism for the failure, that it was somehow damaging like a structure in the wood. Like, I didn't really understand it because I don't know wood structure well enough to know what the hell they were talking about. It was rupturing some kind of structure in the wood and causing it to be weaker. This could seem pretty damning, right? I mean, it's very interesting information. I find it real interesting. But we have to be very careful about drawing conclusions and, you know, making assumptions when we come to extrapolating that to other things. So a couple things that I think of right off are, it wasn't hickory, it's actually pine sapwood. So we have a test that's done that shows damage to pine sapwood. Facts. Let's talk about facts. Facts are supposed to be, you know, something that is definitely known about something. So what do we know? We really know very little. You know, like, I know very little. I know that I read this thing online. I didn't follow it up. You know, I didn't look to see if these guys are legit, if they're published elsewhere, if it's in a publication even. Like, maybe a 14-year-old wrote this in their basement as a joke. Now, I'm not saying that's true, and at some point those speculations become silly, but I'm pointing it out as an important philosophic point, that facts are kind of hard to come by if you really dig deep. There's a difference between like a really hardcore fact and what I would call level of confidence in a piece of information. So we'll keep coming back to that probably. So already I have a fairly high confidence that this is a real scientific paper by, you know, professional scientists, and that it's not just something somebody made up. For instance, you know, this stuff exists on a scale, and that's what I really want to point out. It's like, it's not necessarily always this binary thing, and what they know or what anyone else knows about this and what I know are different. Okay, so we have to be careful about what we consider a fact and what we don't consider a fact. But let's just go and say that these guys, we're going to make the working assumption that these guys are legit and the paper's legit and all that stuff, and that they did these tests the way that they said they did them, and they used, you know, a careful methodology, and that their conclusions that they present are accurate. But what we really know is that there's this paper and it says this, and it says that that's what they did. And is that 100% safe assumption, that they did these tests the way that they said they did them? No. It's not. Science is carried out by people, people are prone to corruption. They have egos. You know, they're thinking about their career and whether, you know, they're going to succeed and what the conclusions are going to mean for them, whether they're, you know, pro or con. There's mercenary scientists that do science in a way that proves what someone wants them to prove. Scientists are funded. This is their job. It's their livelihood. You know, bias, ego, big factors. There's a difference between if you're thinking, well, that's crazy. What are you, some crazy conspiracy dude? No, I didn't say that anything close that these people are doing that. I said, is it 100% safe to conclude that they did this study the way that it says they did it? Now, this again, this is a philosophic point more than a practical point with this discussion. But it's an important one because science is just it's just a name. It's just a stamp and an idea. And when people stamp that on something, there's a certain type of person that tends to just say, oh, scientists said, you know, and then they post it on their Twitter and Facebook and everything, and they just kind of go, and nobody's like reading this stuff and going in and reading the study. Let's get back to that, though. And let's go on the working assumption that they did these tests the way they said they did. Okay, so what do we know from that if we assume those things? Well, facts we could conclude would be those pieces of white pine sapwood that they had, those particular pieces, were damaged by saturation with oil by this certain mechanism. Okay, now we start to extrapolate. Some of these extrapolations may be safe and some of them may not. How far you extrapolate and what you do with that information, yeah, I mean, that's a personal thing. And again, I don't advocate people being paralyzed by overthinking this stuff to death to the point where you don't act. I tried to make that real clear in my last thing. You know, acting on working assumptions is fine. It's just a matter of like how we're going to view this. So now we're going to start extrapolating. So the first extrapolation obviously would be that another batch of linseed oil and another batch of pine sapwood would behave the same way. Then we might extrapolate that pine heartwood would act the same way and have the same damage to it. Then we can extrapolate that other types of drying oils would do the same thing to those woods. Then we can extrapolate that this would happen in other woods, for instance, hickory. Now, is that a safe extrapolation? I would say no. Definitely not. I definitely don't consider that a safe extrapolation. Now, that's my personal judgment, my personal point of view. But, you know, I don't care how you view it and how you act on it. But if you tell me that that's a safe extrapolation, I'm going to beg to differ. For me, I have no idea. It's very interesting information. Very interesting. I think it's real worth thinking about and considering. It's a great piece of the puzzle to add. Am I going to act on it? Well, I have other information. I have someone who who's been saturating their handles for a long time with linseed oil and turpentine. Again, that's not just linseed oil, it's linseed oil and turpentine, so that could behave differently. They're using a different wood, ash in this case, because they only use ash for handles. He said, do it and test it. He's like, get some ash, like, you know, two pieces of ash and saturate one, or, you know, treat them differently and go to a place with a hydraulic press and test it. Him telling me this, he has like absolute confidence that I'm going to find a difference that's going to be, you know, obvious. I have two things to look at here that I'm kind of comparing, right? I have some lab coats. I love that term, lab coats. Some lab coats that are doing a very controlled, very limited, like really, myopic experiment on a totally different wood. I mean, it hardly gets much different than pine sapwood and hickory. And I have someone with a bunch of experience saying, this is how I do it, test it. Like, prove it to yourself that it works. And I have to look at those two things, and they conflict. Now let's talk about something else. And that is that the pressure exerted by a press in four different precise directions, those stresses are not the exact same stresses and behaviors that a long, you know, hardwood handle undergoes on a tool. How are they different? I don't know. I'm not that smart. You know, I can think of some ideas that I could bring up, but the most important, relevant thing there is that I am not making the assumption that I'm smart enough to like figure out all those variables in my head and come to a conclusion and say, yeah, they're the same. There's things I don't know, you know, but what I do know is that these situations are totally different. What I'm trying to get to is, even if the structure of that hardwood is changed, like maybe it becomes, you know, weakened, what does that mean? Like, to me, I'm just not smart enough to understand what that means in real life with these different, totally different situations. Let's say that I did take two pieces of ash that were exactly the same. They're like right next to each other in the wood, you know, in the right way, so that they're very similar. Treat them in different ways, and I test those on a press. Do this 50-50 turpentine linseed oil. So I put that on the press, and I put a dry piece on the press. And I press this one, the dry one, and it goes to a certain amount of pressure, and then it breaks, and it fractures. And I go, okay, well, there it is, let's say 50. Now I take the saturated one, and I start pressing it. And I get to, say, 25 pounds, 30 pounds, 32 pounds, and it starts to go bend past the point where this other one bent. And then it breaks at 42 pounds. Well, those behaviors are different. And when you apply that in real life, there may be something going on that is of a certain benefit, including toughness. Okay, so to say strength, period, I mean, I think it's somewhat contextual. There's not a lot to conclude there, and I have no attachment at all to whether or not, you know, hickory is weakened by being fully saturated or not fully saturated. I don't know. It's just interesting. It's something to think about. But for each one of us, we would have to take that information and say, like, how are we going to act on that? Is this going to prevent us? Is it going to scare us off from doing this, or is it not? Or should we try to, like, maybe not penetrate it all the way? Should we test it? Even if we test it, like, on the press, like I just said, does that tell us, you know, what's going to happen in real life when we're working with this tool? I'm not confident in to say that. What would I do? I probably won't do much of anything different. I've been pretty happy with what I've been doing, and I'll probably just keep doing that and observing. I may do some tests and set things up, and see what more data we could collect. Again, the interpretation of that data is, and the extrapolation especially, are fraught with danger if we're not careful. But data is interesting to have. The other part of the discussion, I think, in the traditional tools blog was that the oil inside the handle may very well not cure. I think that's pretty supportable, actually, because I just showed you that little dish of linseed oil here. Well, these have been, you know, I've had these sitting around for, like I said, maybe as much as over a year. I've lost track. And the top is cured, and it seems to have pretty much stopped the curing of the oil underneath it. So it may very well be that we're getting, like on my handles, a thin rind of cured oil on the outside, and then a layer of oil on the inside. And how long would that take to eventually oxidize inside the handle? So we don't really know what's going on in there, basically. It would be really interesting to cut a handle open that's been cured for years like that, see how much is inside, see if it appears to be saturated, maybe heat it up and see how much it bleeds oil from different parts of the handle or something. But I think overall it would probably be a little bit inconclusive. I was thinking more along the lines of, like, I'm getting penetration for a while, and I don't really know how far it's going, but then at some point it starts to build up towards the outside, and then that starts to cure, and then the penetration slows down. And I was thinking of it more as, like, it's penetrated so far, but it's only saturated so far, and then that's cured into a rind. But those are all, you know, just assumptions on my part. I'm not necessarily advocating saturating the handle. It's just, you know, something this guy told me, but he doesn't use raw pure linseed oil. He's using 50-50 turpentine and linseed oil. So he's saying that our beliefs supersede the facts. So again, I think we need to be real careful about what we consider a fact, and especially its relevance and the safety of extrapolating it further. So then he says, almost certainly, interesting, almost certainly, that's good. Always leave a way out, you know, not just to save your ego from getting beat up when someone comes by and says, you know, you're wrong, but because it's a good way to think. You know, that's what I'm trying to say. That's why I have this thing against certain words like proper, never, belief, always. I don't think those should be scrubbed from the English language. I'll talk more about it sometime, but it has to do with a way of thinking that keeps your options open and keeps you thinking and keeps you asking questions and not shutting doors everywhere. You know, fact is another word that's one of my least favorite words in common usage. You know, often when I see people overuse that word or use it really forcefully, I'm just like, my bullshit detectors just go through the roof. And this has to do with this binary thinking. It's like people running around trying to grasp on to binary ideas, and then they smash each other with them, trying to like prove points. And often, if you examine these things carefully, they're not as clear-cut as you would think. But it's about keeping your options open and keeping your mind open and keeping the question process going. It's not natural. I'm telling you, it ain't natural. We're binary animals. This is a learned behavior. It's unnatural. We have to learn it. It takes effort, it takes time, and it takes a mindset that you have to cultivate and pursue. And it's kind of frustrating. It gets less frustrating the more you do it, because it just becomes a, you know, a habit, and you see the benefits, and it starts to work for you, and it makes sense. But it's a lot more comforting to try to latch on to black and white things and make life simple, because then you don't have to think. You don't have to work on it. It's not just this constant like uncertainty. It's an insecure way to think, to constantly be saying, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. Oh, I kind of know that. Pretty sure I know that, but I don't know this. Yeah. And again, I just want to be super clear that I'm not talking about some intellectual exercise. I'm talking about a practical philosophy and a way of thinking that fosters understanding and insight. And ironically, the result is more questions and more unknowns. So yeah, I'm glad he posted that, and those links were very interesting, and they provide a good conversation. I hope some of you made it through this, and I still have to go out tonight, so I'm gonna cruise. But I wanted to do this because I think it's important to follow up on stuff when it's fresh, and these, I think it's some really good talking points here. You know, both the like practical application stuff and the more like philosophic discussion side of it. And I was asked some other questions about the idea of belief, and kind of people that were like, well, so you believe this, but you don't, and it doesn't make sense to them. And I'm not going to address those right now. All I'm saying is that I advocate, I mean, because we have to get into semantics. Like, if belief doesn't mean the same things, it depends on like how we use it. But I'm trying to communicate something that I think should be fairly obvious, which is that it's unnecessary to adopt belief in something, like a solid, I'm talking about a solid belief and saying like this is a fact, like real binary thinking, before you act. And that's not necessary, but a lot of people do that, and a lot of people feel they need to do it, like they're scared to act unless they know. But it's more beneficial, and it causes you to think deeper and be more open to options if you think in terms of working assumptions instead of belief. That's all I'm trying to say there. All right, good night.